Hi and welcome everyone. I am Divya Jyoti and I am a content manager at EPW Engage. We are honored to have Professor Gopal Guru with us and we hope to end the year with his valuable and critical insights. Professor Guru is an eminent political scientist who has opened up new avenues and given new perspectives on the debate on caste in India. His edited work on humiliation, claims, and context is an important contribution to the Indian social sciences, along with his other major work, The Cracked Mirror, an Indian debate on experience and theory, which he co-authored with Sundar Sarukai, a compelling work in understanding Dalit experiences. Professor Guru has also been the editor of EPW since 2018, and it is an absolute honor to work under his guidance. I welcome you to this live session, sir. And yeah, so like I'll begin with the first question then.
Thank you, Divya.
Yes, sir. So EPW's first issue of 2021, published on the 2nd of January, had your take on the farmers' protest, where you wrote that it is needless to mention that the power of the farmers' protest is to expose the link between the formal power of the state and the real power of the corporates. What would you say were the key political motivations of the success of the farmers' movement? Why has this been the singular most successful protest in the regime of current government? Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Divya. I think the farmers' movement has four distinct successes to its credit. Number one, that it was the most worked out, unified, So this is first character dimension of the farmers' movement. The second special feature of the farmers' movement is that, you know, it actually for the first time made the nexus between corporate and the governing corporate class and the governing class as a part of the commonses. People came to know about the nexus, and they were discussing, both formally and informally through meetings, what is the connection between the ruling class, that is the corporate, and the governing class, that is the ruling party. So this was actually done by the Marxist communist thinking, but for the first time you find that this is becoming the part of the common sense. So this is the second dimension of the farmers' movement. The third dimension is that it actually led to the moral hegemony through political solidarity that it produced. That is to say that farmers were actually supported by different sections of the society, the minorities, the Dalits, the other sections of the society. Of course, political parties were there supporting from outside, but the social groups actually associated themselves with the cause of the farmers. And so that is the third dimension. The fourth dimension is actually, it actually exposed the link between the corporate accumulating, amplifying its profit, and the governing class, that is the ruling party, actually using this to perpetuate its own rule. So these are four dimensions that were so prominently present in the farmers' movement that we have seen during the last 1 year.
So moving on to the next question. Physical or material labor done from outside the home and the intellectual or symbolic labor which could be done from home. The social surveillance in such cases gets mediated by the disciplinary power of the employer. In this regard, it needs to be noted that it is temporary and that it only points at a large problem should work from home become the norm. Walking into the third year of the pandemic still looming over the world at large, what do you think the pandemic has done to the relationship between the employer, labor, and home?
I think this the spell of pandemic has actually introduced a lot of conceptual changes in the relationship between the employer, employee, and the employee, and the workplace.
Yes.
Pandemic, for obvious reason, has actually changed the very concept of workplace.
Yes.
It is no more a stable, material, established place. It is almost a virtual place.
Yes.
Working from home means you are working from home virtually through webinars, through Zoom, through other things.
Yeah, absolutely.
So your workplace has become flexible. You can work from anywhere. It's a mobile play space.
Yeah.
So it's not a stationary space. So that actually leads to some kind of a division in labor,
yeah.
labor organizing labor power. For example, intellectuals by and large could work from home, whereas daily wage labor or farmers or women working on the field had no luxury to work from home. I'm saying luxury within quotes.
Yeah.
So that is one change that was resulted from the pandemic.
Yeah.
So this is one change. The other important change that pandemic has introduced in the concept of accumulation of profit is this, that you are you no more require a physical presence in the farm or a factory. You can always add to the profit of a farm or a factory by working from home through codifications of data, webinars, computer simulation, and other modes of actually contributing to the profit of the farm. So this is something which was not the case earlier. Yeah, visual dimension of the labor has added more power of extracting labor as well as profit.
Mm.
So that is the change that pandemic has introduced in the notion of accumulating profit.
So, sorry to interrupt you, sir, but your video is not coming. Yeah, I think there is some. If you could just it's gone again.
It's gone. Okay, I'll say. Okay.
Yes.
So this is the the third point is that though working from home has become much more intellectualized, that you are dealing with labor through your mental exercise, your calculations, your codifications.
Mm-hmm.
Your webinars, your computer simulations, and graphics, designs, and other things, you are adding to the profit of the firm for which you are working.
Yeah.
At the same time, you are actually also increasing the burden of the family.
Yeah.
Your notion of privacy has undergone a sea change.
Yes.
That the firm has actually walked into your drawing room.
Yeah, absolutely.
The employee is actually monitoring and keeping an eye, so to say, through different devices, making phone calls and actually regulating your time, though you are in your house. So in a way, virtually, the firm or the employer has walked into your drawing room, thereby actually disrupting your privacy that you had earlier.
Yeah,
so that
absolutely.
Is the cultural and social implication of the pandemic. That we have been facing,
especially with artificial.
Fourth, I think the burden on women has increased.
Yes, sir. Absolutely. Yes.
They have not only worked for the farm. They have to also work.
Yeah.
Within the house.
Yeah.
Because the maid servant, and all those upper middle class families who had the luxury privilege to employ maid servant, were not able to actually employ them. And they were actually contributing to the labor, domestic labor.
Yeah.
Sometimes some considerate or reasonable husbands would really support partners would support them.
Yeah.
But this was not the norm.
Yeah. Yes. Absolutely. Absolutely true.
Yeah.
Moving on to our third question for the evening. So, can we say that there is a religio-cultural homogenization of India happening in the present times? How is this affecting the marginalized communities and the future to come? How do you basically look at the concept of tolerance and how is it impacting the marginalized sections of the society?
The binary between the tolerance and the intolerance is a universal problem, but it has become more intensified during the last few
Yes.
years. People, and the ruling class or the governing class or the ruling party has become absolutely intolerant of any democratic dissent, and we can see the evidence of this happening everywhere on an everyday basis. So there is a binary between, there's a tension between tolerance and intolerance. Now, intolerance actually is on the rise, as we can see, but tolerance would demand that you are accommodative, you are adjustable, you are compassionate, you respect others. All that will constitute
The
the
concept
principle
of
of tolerance,
tolerance,
the concept or principle of tolerance. That actually has almost resulted in silencing some of the social groups who actually, for some reason, historical reasons, belong to the margin, socioeconomic religious margin. They have not been able to actually speak openly and put their point of view openly. So there is some kind of intolerance. Intolerance actually is manifested through silencing people, attacking them, calling them jhollawalas, trolling them, and all kinds of devices are used to actually silence them, calling them tukle tukle gang without any verification whether there was a tukle tukle gang or not. I mean, this was something one-sided
Narrative.
accusation that was never that is never proved or verified through rigorous processes. As we know, actually, what was the demand of the farmers? Farmers' demand was to actually allow us to actually participate in the deliberative process. The demand was for actually asking for deliberation, and the issues of the farm laws needed to be sorted out through deliberation. But that was not allowed. So that it only means that, you know, there's a lack of tolerance of the dissent. And so this is, and then you want to, do you want to access truth? True tolerance. You can access truth only through tolerance, not truth. You can access the lies only through intolerance. So that is the divide. Truth and lies, intolerance and tolerance. There is a set of, there's a logical connection. Lies with intolerance, truth with tolerance.
Tolerance,
I mean, it's a rough division, not a complete, very fairly worked out comparison, but it is there.
No, very insightful, sir. With respect to this question only, there's another question that I would like to point out. In your editorial titled Two Faces of Injustice, you argue that the rape atrocities against women in general and women from the oppressed castes in particular continue to bear two faces of injustice, active and passive. Do you think passive injustice plays a larger role in the moral degradation of society in contrast to the active injustice? Don't you think that this behavior of passivity leads to the active forms of discrimination?
Yes, definitely. I think this the division between the active and the passive injustice is actually drawn from one of the very important American political philosopher, Judith Scalar, and I have actually taken it from her work on Two Faces of
Injustice.
Injustice. So we can easily see that, you know, the forms of injustice actually lead to discrimination. Now, what is this discrimination? That let's first of all, as I discuss in this, let's discuss what is active injustice. Active injustice is that which is actually committed by first a singular against minorities, women, Dalit, Adivas, in all the suppressed classes of the society. There is active involvement, that the first person involvement creating a crime or injustice. But Passive injustice is that which is actually done by people who are not the part of the actual act of crime or atrocity. They are onlookers, bystanders, who are there, do not intervene in the act of injustice done by others. They are onlookers. In fact, they are not only onlookers, they also take vicarious pleasure by watching it. And we have several examples of this in our country. People don't participate.
No, never.
Maybe they have their own reasons because they are also afraid and they may be implicated into some legal tangle and other things. That's why
Absolutely.
They stay away. But you know, you require to intervene.
Yeah. Responsibility as an individual, responsibility as a moral individual.
You have a responsibility to actually intervene and stop or prevent the injustice. Was a whistleblower, so to say. The whistleblower is the one who can really prevent.
And it's always whistleblower is always considered in a negative light, but actually when in the cases of injustices, it becomes very important to blow this entire scenario out.
We have seen the women UTZing, assault on women. People don't intervene. They are bystanders. So that is also equally bad. I mean, that is equally bad in the sense that it's passive forms of injustice.
You are
not doing active. So that is that has been there and it has increased over a period of time during the last few years. It has increased. People don't really they enjoy actually, so to say. That's called vicarious pleasure.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. I think media also has a lot of role to play in this. And
media plays a very I would say some media plays a dubious role. Media plays a very pivotal role. Bringing those images, otherwise you wouldn't know what is happening.
Absolutely, absolutely.
So aspect of social media actually is doing good service, a good job of bringing those images to
us.
So otherwise, as they say, the doctored
videos
or media wouldn't be interested in actually bringing reality to you. The images that actually show you social reality. That is the unfortunate development in terms of the media.
Absolutely. So the last question for you for the evening is, in the light of COVID-19, how has the transformation of classrooms and teaching methods affected the students from marginalized communities? As a teacher, how would you have addressed the issue of teaching important concepts which have been diluted in the current process?
I think historically, classroom is not an innocent structure where people go, teachers go and sit and exchange views and the syllabus is transacted. Classroom is also a structure which has some power division. That is to say, the power of the teacher is enormous, and there is also a remote corner which doesn't speak at all in the classroom situation. One corner is very vocal, the other corner is more or less mute and silent. They are already flabbergasted because of their socioeconomic and educational cultural background. One can see that even in very renowned institutions of our country. Very progressive looking institutions. So that is already divided. So so you have no access to good material. Material that will empower you to participate in the classroom discussions. Now you also don't have any access to teachers who for some reasons have no time to really deal with you. Because they have their own pressures, their peer group pressures, their publication pressures, their preparation pressures, and all kinds of pressures are there, as a result of which a teacher, though ready to really help, but is not able to help. So these are that creates some kind of a divide and defeated among those people who require special attention. This has been before pandemic, but after pandemic, this asymmetry in the classroom has widened because you know now it is technology that will enable you to participate in the discussion and deliberation and communication. You require to have a smartphone.
Yeah,
most of the students of kids from poor families do not have this smartphone, and without smartphone you cannot really you can't
access the classroom.
You can't connect with the classroom, online teaching. So this is the
digital divide.
There is a digital divide that is happening, and so pandemic has actually led to this kind of a digital divide, which is actually created some kind of a inequality in accessing a good quality education. That of course is very serious problem. So there are some organizations. Somebody is drilling somewhere.
It's okay, sir. It's okay.
So this is the situation. But the other problem is that there was in the this also I covered that I went to the other room.
Okay, sir. Classroom.
Committee, CRT or some, the committee actually took the decision of reducing 30%
syllabus,
of the workload. The syllabus. But that is not the point. The point is, what is the burden? The burden is not in terms of volume. But burden in terms of the conceptual burden. As Professor and Professor Krishna Kumar has done a wonderful work on this. And this concept of conceptual incomprehension is the biggest burden that the students carry. This conceptual incomprehension is the term given by late Professor Yashpal. So we have no idea how to deal with this conceptual incomprehension. Maybe because we actually import concepts as they are without any qualification, modification, moderation, and without really recontextualizing them in our own experience. We should really do something else. What is that? That, you know, you have to take examples which are very close to your lived life and try to actually mediate these concepts through those examples. That is to say, you can explain those concepts by using your lived experience as such. If you take a very abstract concepts and try to actually transact them without any transact them mechanically without any reference to reality, I think that would really create conceptual incomprehension. And therefore, I think what is important is to actually train teacher to see that they actually use this concept so efficiently and also aesthetically to empower students to think of themselves. So that is, that is what is needed actually.
Absolutely true, absolutely. So yeah, I think that would be like all. And thank you so much for joining us on Facebook Live. And thank you so much for your insightful, for such a wonderful and insightful session.
And I hope thanks Priyam and Lisa for organizing this discussion. And I wish all the friends of EPW a better 2022.
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So should we
stay on or we? I would just like to tell my tell our viewers that just to like, share, and subscribe to EPW's Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, and Spotify pages.
Working from home is this problem. Somebody was reading in the next door.
Absolutely. And with artificial intelligence and different kinds of softwares coming in, you have to continuously sit on the screen. You cannot even leave the screen for 10 seconds because that software would know that there is no activity being done on the laptop. And I don't know how it will improve the productivity, but what I can see is, in a way, it's affecting the health of the labor class and working class.
Yes, very much. So should we exit now?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Thank
Thank
you
you.
so much, sir.
Thank you all.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you, sir.